Just kill me till then to give up this fight. And I will give up this fight. 'Cause I can't make you love me if you don't. You can't make your heart feel something it won't. Here in the dark, these final hours, I will lay down my heart and I'll feel the power, but you won't. No, you won't. 'Cause I can't make you love me if you don't. The day I found you, I want to stay around you, and so I beg you, let it be. Don't take this heaven from one. Must cling to someone now and forever. Let it be me. Each time we meet, love, I find complete love. Without your sweet love, what would life be? So never leave me lonely. Tell me you love me only, and that you. That let it be me. Little boy in a baseball hat stands in the field with his ball and bat. Says, I am the greatest player of them all. Puts his bat on his shoulder and he tosses up his ball. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down, swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. The baseball falls down. Now the little boy doesn't say a word. He picks up his ball. He is undeterred. Says, I am the greatest there has ever been. Teeth and he tries it again. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down, swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. He makes no excuse, he shows no fear. He just closes his eyes and listens to the cheers. Little boy, he adjusts his hat, picks up his ball, stares at his bat. Says, I am great. The game is on the line. Gives his all one last time. And the ball goes up like the moon so bright, swings his bat with all his might. The world's as still as still can be, and the baseball falls. That's strike three. Now it's supper time, and his mama calls. Little boy starts home with his bat and ball. Says, I am the greatest. That is a fact. But even I didn't know it like that. Says, I am the greatest. That is understood. But even I didn't know I could pitch that good.
for all you've done for me, showing me things I didn't see. Just because you love me, how could this be? This is why I write a song that sings your praise. I'm in my head saying you, Lord, for the joy you gave to me. Can you say with me? This is love.
Love, love, love.
Come on, you know what I'm saying. dancing too. So come on, baby, search my heart. You know I'll never leave you. You knew that from the start. And we got to stick together, hold on to my dream. No matter what the weather, baby, can't you see? Sam Cooke on that bad boy right there. Oh, 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 guys, help me tonight. The two of you. You say, what did we say? My knees, babe. I know somebody on the stage how to beg. What's done? What you gonna do, Kurt?
searching for that special kind of lady. Yeah, yeah. That can make me get down, way down on the knee. The one who knows how to cook curry, all the way from South Africa. Is she in the house tonight? Sorry. My wife is the one that knows how to make a good curry. Oh, 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 my wife knows how to make any curry in a hurry. She don't waste no time. I'm so glad I got up like that every day. I'm so glad I found love every day. Help me say, come on, say, I'm a need, baby. The song. I remember when we used to sit the government yard in Frenchtown. Oh, I mean, hypocrites mingling with the good people we meet. Good friends we had, good friends we lost along, along the way. In this great future, can't forget your past. So dry yours, I say. No woman, no cry. No woman, no cry. Little, little darling, don't
tears. No, no woman, no pride. I said I remember when you said in the government shot in Trenchtown. Then the Georgian would make the firelight, that would burn in fire through the night. Then we'd cook, porridge, of which I share with you. It was my only carriage, and so I'm gonna push, jump through, yeah. Don't cry, no.
Thank you. Sing love, don't say goodbye. I said love's always been a hit. But she lost the melody, the words would never fit. Then breath to breath, I kissed her lips. She smiled and sighed and said, my soul remembers this. Oh, sing me your love song. Sing me your love song again. Sing me your love song. Sing me your love.
there are some people at the top, and there are some people, you know, so the people at the top, they are the leaders, and the people below, they are the ones following the leader.
Tuzidi kutafia na ya.
Just define it like that. There are some people at the top, and there are some people at the top, and there's.
We have good leaders, to be honest with you, but they just kind of applying rules and regulations that they really don't have an idea of.
Leaders in Africa, the only thing I'll talk about them is how they don't see themselves. They are always wanting to. They want their country to look like one particular country uptown. Most citizens, I'll say 85% listen to what the government say or the leader say, and the rest of them they don't earn from the government directly, so they don't care about what the leader say.
Hey, I'm in our hands in a day. So please, baby, born in Pa, encourage you. They on your necessity because in the middle, Mahama or Mahama Baye, got any mutin for Adam and Mahama, no small zoom lion for. I was in the middle, got an old Benufiano, 1 year Bayer, and maybe I too. Now, Yana say, wait, I was losing it then. I buy something like a cockaboo account. It's all that I was in the year BBN or the other two. When you had a dumb rambay, I was a bit my support.
We have to engage them. On whatever platform it is, whether it's on Twitter, Facebook, or even radio stations, we just have to engage them, speak to them on what it is that we want, and follow through. So if a leader promises you that it's going to build a road on this particular stretch of a place or whatever, we should not just wait 4 years later for them to come and tell us that they've done it, right? We literally need to talk to them on a daily basis, because ultimately, we employ them. They work for us.
Changes now. Like, talking about the future, I don't think there's future for them or Africa. So if they want to change, they should start it now. Let's see the change.
As a leader, your duty is to impact your views, your visions into your people, right? As an entrepreneur, the road is tough. It's not for everybody. It's not a joke. Let's not make entrepreneurship a sexy thing. It's not a joke. But it's worthwhile in the end, because if you want to change the world, then you have to kind of deal with yourself. And that's pretty much what entrepreneurs are.
From my own perspective, I make sure my people that work for me, they are well, like, they are satisfied. You get it? Like, I make sure they are okay. so that they don't think I'm bad or they don't want to leave. I'm sure everything I do, I don't benefit more, like excess more than them.
I'm amazing there. Me, I'm a major man. I'm saying you'll be busy. Now, be busy. Hey, you'll be busy. You call down. I also was over called. I'm there. Amazing. Me, I'm a supply. Intimidate me there. Oh, some money and time. But before was the number show. Into the man saying I'm a major now. I'm in me there. Some money and time. But before being in there, know what the best show one into. Or let me make the attempt to there. The word time or let me do. You know, let me do. The man saying me, you'll be soon as that.
Biko and Sankara. But if I had to choose now, I would. There's nobody, really nobody, because I don't believe that there's any particular leader that is doing what it needs to be done. But surprisingly, if I had to choose, I would say Muhammad.
I can't say, but I love it. But it's. This is that man that I read so much about him. I'll say he's my mentor.
Because I feel like of all the African leaders, he's the only person that has the air of diplomacy around him.
That's a big question. I don't want to mention it. I have a favorite, but I don't want to mention that. I don't want to mention it.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome, everyone. Great, great, great. I want to actually thank everybody for coming here and honoring our invitation. We also welcome our great speakers who have actually, some of them have traveled from Kenya to the city of Accra. Was very excited. Raphael Obonyo, thank you for coming. It's very exciting seeing you here. Mr. Jesse Japon, that's my former boss. Very powerful man. He always tells me. Thank you for coming. Dr. Issy Ansah, a renowned leadership coach. She is very good in what she does, and we all know the kind of good work she actually does. And I will not even turn my head because Franklin Cudjoe is known everywhere. Franklin, thank you for coming. We are very grateful for your invitation. This event actually, my name is James Nyakon. I'm the founder and CEO of Transition Africa. Transition Africa is a leadership think tank. We actually develop leadership models to train individuals and group of leaders to responsibly bring about change in the society here in Africa. Actually, our focus areas are leadership, governance, and sustainable development. So this evening, we are actually going to discuss quite some number of issues to do with leadership in Africa, basically, as to whether leadership is indeed the bane of our problems we have on our continent. It's actually an arguable fact that people attribute the underdevelopment of some countries in Africa to the kind of leaders that we actually have. And indeed, is really the bane of our problems we have. We've had our own, freedom out of colonialism. Are we able to do it ourselves as Africans? So we are pretty much sure that this event should elicit the kind of information we need to deliberate on as we look for information to really solve our problems. We are actually going to go beyond this forum. More often than not, I mean, there are a lot of talk shops here in Africa because people actually know us to be talkers, basically, and we actually do not take actions. But we believe in leadership in action, that to really inspire somebody, you would have to inspire through your actions rather than talking. His Excellency, former President John Agyekum Kuffour, presiding bishop of the Methodist Church Ghana, Bishop Titus, our triprat, diplomatic missions here, student leaders for the various tertiary institutions, friends in the media, friends joining us across the world via our live streaming platform, ladies and gentlemen. Each day, basic facts about Africa question the integrity and capability of every individual, organization, and government. Kindly permit me to acknowledge some of these facts. Africa remains the second largest continent in the world, and for that matter, has one of the largest human resources to leverage. Africa accounts for more than 50% of the world's natural resources and therefore has the brightest opportunity to grow. Paradoxically, Africa is the most economically deprived continent in the world, according to the World Bank. The threats of war, terrorism, and other forms of violence hinder social economic progress in many of its countries. Though corruption is as good as a pandemic that eats into the resources and the image of every country, Africa is considered the most vulnerable to corruption, according to the Corruption Watch. For these and similar facts, The continent of Africa is a special one for good and bad. The fact that Africa has the opportunity to become a better continent is not the best one. If not the best one, is breathtaking. In recent years, we see some of eight countries making giant strides on the basis of improving or restoring national peace and achieving appreciable economic growth. Nigeria, for instance, has been successful to a considerable extent in controlling the devastating influence of Boko Haram in its domain in the last 10 months. Oliver August in 2013 reported in the Economics newspaper that Africa remained a fast growing economy until the year 2025, with a yearly growth of about 6%. His report was based on current performance rate of the African economy. Moreover, every country such as South Africa, Botswana, Namibia, and Angola have maintained an encouraging GDP growth rate to date. In fact, Africa is making the needed economic, socio-economic changes in an interesting pace, said Oliver August. This situation is the outcome of efforts being made by the African society, which we at Transition Africa consider a distinctive institution made up of two groups of stakeholders, the citizenry and the national leaders. Primarily, the growth of institutions is driven by efforts made by all stakeholders. As an institution, therefore, Africa's leaders and citizenry have a role to play towards leapfrogging the continent's economic and social conditions. It could be argued that citizens in Africa often think that social economic growth is a product of national leaders, with majority of Africans not formally educated. This and similar misconceptions may have compelled many citizens to sit on the fence whilst the struggle to grow the continent is underway. We, however, have to admit that corruption is becoming an enormous threat to the continent's growth. Undoubtedly, the continent's leadership is highly questionable with corruption in view. Ensuring effective leadership and governance should be the ultimate agenda of any country pursuing significant positive change. This agenda is best pursued in the strength of the collaborative quotas contributed by citizens and national leaders. Yet both leaders and citizens must be well informed and equipped to play their respective roles. The birth of Transition Africa accompanies the goal of grappling with issues that create a wide divide between national leaders and productivity, and which makes citizens and their leaders less knowledgeable about their civil responsibilities. Transition Africa's formation shall be geared towards providing opportunities for leaders and potential leaders to identify the prestige of pursuing noble and productive leadership. At Transition Africa, we believe the rate of economic recovery in Africa can be faster and more enormous if leadership in African countries is more productive and honest. Transition Africa shall apply a combination of administrative tools, with research playing a pivotal role in this vein, to better understand the foundations of effective leadership and governance. Transition Africa shall give priority to the inclusion of every building block of society: students, people, industries, government, in its endeavor to use robustly designed research to identify general life issues that threaten governance and leadership in Africa. Disseminating empirical and factual information in a manner that corrects the drawbacks of leadership and governance in a part of our quest at Transition Africa. We endeavor to contribute towards giving Africa the fast transition to the middle income status predicted by the World Bank and even better social economic statuses. Transition Africa aims to develop and promote leadership development models to train individuals and groups of leaders to responsibly bring about social change and sustainable development in Africa. Our focus areas are leadership, governance, and sustainable development. Ladies and gentlemen, Transition Africa has some groundbreaking programs that hopes to partner organizations with shared vision and committed to bringing positive change in Africa. One key program is an award scheme that recognizes the distinguished leadership and governance practices of student leaders and educational establishments. The scheme would help set standards for student leaders as a means to enhancing their contribution towards the development of Africa's educational setup. This will prepare student leaders for the realities of good governance at the national and other levels of governance, and also as a motivation to enhance quality leadership skills of these student leaders and developing them as problem-solving young leaders to engineer development in our society. Transition Africa is a non-governmental organization that has come to complement the immense contribution of great organizations such as IMANI, IDEC, CDD, just to mention a few, by using research and related programs to better understand leadership and governance issues and their solutions. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce the moderator for the Leadership Factor, Mr. Bernard Koku Avle. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, James Nyaku. Some of you don't look too happy, but give him a round of applause. I noticed where some of you were looking at him as he was speaking. James Nyaku is a great young man with a brilliant idea that we all want to support. My name is Bernard Avle. It's a joy to be here with you tonight here at Asante Hall Alisa Hotel. We're privileged to be part of a conversation. I talk for a living, and it's not even the kind of talk that you do. I don't give speeches. I just ask people questions, and as they answer, I say, and they pay me money for it. It's a really good job, and I love it. Tonight, we're going to have a conversation about leadership, which I'm sure all of you believe is the most important factor in development, but it's a different kind of leadership conversation. So we've broken down leadership into five components, and we've invited five of the best young brains on the continent to help us plow through the issue. But that's still not all. The panel discussion is just part of tonight, because we'll be hoping for your voice and your views, your interaction as well. And as the program proceeds, we'll bring you in to help us have a more rounded conversation. If it's a good idea, give everybody a nice round of applause so that we know we are in good company. So I have five persons I'll be speaking to. One will join us on Google Hangout, but four of them are here. I'll give a brief introduction of each, and please show appreciation as I do that by applauding them when I finish. So to my extreme right and your extreme left is a man I know very well. He runs one of Africa's most influential think tanks. They were ranked number 2 in Africa recently. I think Franklin Cudjoe is perfecting the art of a modern think tank. That is, they work with a small team, but they are very dynamic, and they keep pushing the boundaries of accountability with well-researched advocacy. Ladies and gentlemen, Franklin Cudjoe. Sitting next to him is a lady I've come to admire, who is a great mentor and teacher of leadership. She has many, many parts to her. I'll give you just 4. She teaches at Ashesi University. She doesn't lecture, she teaches. That's number 1. Number 2, she is the patron of a couple of organizations, one of which I'm a board member of, the PAVA Foundation, as well as a foundation that helps aged people. She's also doing some part-time work with the Africa Leadership Initiative for West Africa, and she has time beyond all of this to run her own consultancy, which is a human resource and leadership consultancy. So Dr. Asi Ansah is also on the panel. Round of applause for her. Our third panelist is so good, we have to fly him all the way from Kenya to Accra. He's a public policy and youth expert, has more than a decade of experience working across various sectors. He's won awards too many to mention, but his experience spans government, private sector, and non-governmental organizations, and he effectively helps to bridge the gap between policy and community solutions. He's also the author of a book, Conversations About the Youth in Kenya, ladies and gentlemen, Raphael Obonyo. Sitting next to him is a man I've known for many years as well. He's now the marketing director of Tigo Ghana. Vast levels of experience in driving revenue growth in telecommunications. Worked with Philips, Airtel, Guinness, and also with a few other companies. When we were in university, he was our landlord, which means he was the town crier for our main hall. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesse Agyepong. And last but not least, joining us on Google Hangout, we are privileged to have one of the most influential young Nigerians, born in Kaduna, attended the prestigious King's College, obtained a law degree from JOS, called the Nigerian Bar some 15 years ago, worked at several firms, including Chief Fe Babalola San. You know Nigerians don't play with their titles. He is also the founder and president of Chocolate City Group, a media and tech company founded in 2005. And he's chairman of the Copyright Society of Nigeria, Nigeria's Digital Music Monitoring Group, and he holds other positions and fellowships. Our fifth guest will join us on Google Hangout, Audu Maikori. You just clap for him. He's behind me. Okay, Audu, I have many talents, but I don't have eyes behind my head. So you need to say something for me to know you are there. Audu, are you there?
Yes, I'm. Can you hear me? I'm here.
Okay, I can hear you, so you are here. Brilliant. Now, what we've tried to do is to compartmentalize leadership into five key areas. So the role of the citizen is crucial, integrity being the essence of leadership, excellence being one manifestation of leadership, innovation being a prerequisite to attain good leadership, and of course, entrepreneurship being another manifestation. So to make life simple, I've allocated one subtopic to each panelist, and they're going to address that subtopic. But before we get into that, I think the general question to start with is, in discussing transformation in Africa, how crucial is leadership? I'm going to take opening remarks for just 30 seconds. I'll start with Franklin. Is leadership the missing key when it comes to Africa's transformation, or is something else, Franklin?
Well, good evening, everyone. And thank you so much, James, for bringing us all together. I think this is a wonderful program, and it needs to be sustained. Bernard, the question you posed essentially is the reason that for Africa's, if you like, predicament, all through history, and I'm talking post-independent Africa, almost all the accolades we've heard, well, Africa was a dark continent, it was a shackled continent, Africa was a hopeless continent, and indeed, Africa, at the point, was set to living in an age of renaissance. Then we heard that Africa was becoming, or Africa was rising. Now we are hearing Africa is transforming. Almost all these accolades have actually been, if you like, within time, have been credited to the leadership on the continent. So much as it is important to discuss the, if you like, the institutions that are responsible or the challenges that we have on the continent, it is very important to situate this conversation in some perspectives. We think that all these accolades are actually have been coined by leaders at the time and actually leave them. And unfortunately, we are still here discussing whether Africa will come out of its hole. So indeed, leadership is a crucial factor to the extent that even the very themes that are supposed to take us out of our doldrums have been coined by the leaders, but okay, they have no clue as to how to get us out of.
So you agree. So recently I interviewed Asi Ansah on my radio show, and she's hiving off a lot of things she does, but keeping the leadership component. So I'm sure the answer is obvious. Why is leadership so central in your view to this continent's transformation?
Thanks a lot, Bernard. Thanks, James. I think it's absolutely critical because it's, for me, it's that key that begins to unlock credibility of leaders. You know, so one, I think two words. In fact, let me give a quick preface. Two words that I think we either need to ban or define: corruption and then integrity and leadership. In fact, maybe that three, where it's this nebulous thing. And leadership, not, I would cancel that and say good leadership.
Okay.
There's a qualifying factor.
Okay.
So good leadership for me is absolutely critical. When you look at the African countries that seem to be doing well, doing better, where politically things are stable, the economy is working well, you will find signs of good leadership. So yes, it's absolutely critical.
Raphael, what would you say? Leadership?
Yeah, first of all, I want to thank James. I'm extremely excited to be in Ghana. This has always been my dream. You know, they say Ghana is the gateway to Africa. So if you've been to any country in Africa and you haven't been to Ghana, then you come through the back door.
Brilliant.
Leadership is extremely various revolutions in Africa, starting with colonization, post-colonial. We talked about Africa Renaissance, Africa Rising, and now Africa Transformation. We realize that the missing link
is actually leadership. Leadership is extremely key. For us to make progress as communities, as countries, and as a continent, we need to make sure that we have the right leadership in place. Without fixing that, then we'll have questions with the sustainability of our growth. We'll have problems today with the shape of the future of Africa that we desire. But yeah, leadership is critical.
Thank you. Jesse, when we were in the university, you were the official town crier of our hall. You were very charismatic. But now you've transitioned into a very respected corporate leader. What's the centrality of leadership?
Can you turn this one off? Hello? Hello?
You're on. Yes, okay. Yes, right.
See, I'll take a step back a little.
Okay.
And my first point will be around the fact that 2 days ago, or I think yesterday,
yeah.
We heard Boris Johnson step down. He's no longer interested in being Prime Minister for the UK.
Yeah.
About a week ago, David Cameron said, for the future of Great Britain, he's not sure that he's the one fit to lead Great Britain in that direction. And that takes me to something which has been the passion of my life for a long time.
Okay.
That you are either fit for purpose or you are not fit for purpose. And increasingly, I've come to believe that there are many leadership issues that we have today because we probably have leaders in place who are not fit for the purpose.
Okay.
And a leader could be fit for different things. But when you put a leader in a place where the leader is not in a good place to execute that which he must do, then it becomes a misplaced priority for the country. So my basic assumption is the fact that if a leader is not fit for purpose, there will be challenges. And if the leader is not fit for purpose, there is a misdirection. If not for purpose, then we are running a visionless drive.
Okay.
So fit for purpose is something that we need to fixate ourselves on for a very long time.
Okay.
If Africa would have to develop.
Brilliant stuff from my opening panel. Let me go to Nigeria and take the opening remarks of Audu. Audu, I know you can hear me. How central is leadership to the Africa conversation?
Well, I think the very, very obvious fact that there's a fact that there's a problem in Africa. But I think one of the problems is how is leadership? You see, we're hoping that we're going to find leaders that are naturally born to lead. But it doesn't really happen by nature. It comes by nurture. So there needs to be training. There needs to be a process by which we develop the next set of leaders. And what I find in Africa is that we're not doing that. And that's why you find that leadership in Africa is an old man's game and it's not a young person's game. And one of the issues that you will see, obviously, too, is that if the average age of the African is 19 years and the average leader's age is 62, closer to 70 years, averagely, then we have a problem. So the question is that what is the connect between those who are leading now and how are they grooming the next set of leaders? And this applies whether it be enterprise, whether it be in governance, whether it be in the academics. What is the process by which we're going to move people from being excited or interested in leading people, and how are we going to transfer those skills? And I think that that is a central issue. And once that is sorted, then you will see a change in Africa, because it's always been about leadership.
Thank you, Audu. So I feel I need to get a working definition for leadership, because it would be funny to have a conversation, discussion, something that we may have open views on. So let me revert to AC. Give us a working definition for leadership. There are many definitions. I heard somebody say a leader is the person who has influence. Other persons say a leader is somebody who makes today's impossibilities tomorrow's reality. Give us a working definition, the teacher that you are, that would agree to use throughout this conversation.
I think a few key words will help us with the definition. One is influence, positive influence, and then two, positive transformation. Mm. You know, so leadership is about individuals using different skill sets to influence people positively, with the end game in mind being positive transformation. So whether you're in the family, whether you are in the workplace, whether at the national level, using the right skills or the appropriate skills to influence people positively so that the end result is positive transformation.
So positive to the power three. I like that. Round of applause for Issa. I think that's a good working definition. Using your skill set to positively influence a situation to create positive results. So Franklin, let's talk about citizen leadership. What do we mean by citizen leadership? And what would you say the state of citizen leadership is on the continent? Are we seeing citizens take the lead as much as we should? Please give us a few thoughts on that.
Well, my understanding of citizen leadership would be that it's essentially filling that gap that supposedly had been left by bad leadership. But also, we can suggest that citizen leadership means that the other part of the social contract, because as you know, citizens elect the people they want to govern them. So in actual fact, while expecting those who have been elected to play their role, citizens must also ensure that they perform their civic duties of not just paying the tax, but actually ensuring that the tax is used productively. But the second part of my understanding of citizen leadership, and for which I think across the continent has gained some roots, it's also because of the abdication of responsible leadership by those who are put in power. So if it is either the Arab Spring and the Arab uprising, or indeed pockets of angst that are expressed across most parts of Africa, it's a manifestation of our citizens that have responded to the crisis. So it's a combination of responsibility as a citizen, not just performing your civic duties, but actually ensuring that whereas the people like the deficits that we see in governance, the deficit that we see in economic governance, citizens are able to use whatever tools they have, especially in this day and age when we have a lot of social media, to express the collective interest. So that to me is citizen leadership.
Okay, now, somebody said important agreement.
Own progress, people will be mobilized because there's credibility. You know, so I think absolutely integrity is key, but we have to define it. Otherwise, it's just fluffy, sexy words for websites, and that's it.
So you define it as honest transparency.
Mm-hmm. Consistent.
And consistent. Interesting. Let me turn to Raphael. So I want to talk to you a bit about, I want you to talk to me a bit about excellence. What is excellence doing in the soup of leadership? How is it important? Is it the core part? Should we even be talking about excellence at all when we discuss leadership?
Yeah, certainly we should talk about excellence. It's extremely important. And I can talk about it in three parts. One, a leader must be someone with a vision. You know, a vision is a sense of direction. Because, like they've always said, a leader is someone who knows the way, goes the way, and shows other people that way. If you do not have a vision, if you do not have an aim, if you do not have a goal, then you cannot mobilize people towards that direction. So vision would be something extremely important in terms of achieving excellence. The second thing I think would be about courage. And courage is about conquering fear and inspiring other people to be able to follow you or follow particular goal. There are many people who can do what you're doing, but they're afraid. But the thing that makes you a leader is because you have the courage to conquer and to overcome the fear. So courage helps you to also achieve excellence. The third issue, which I find very important, is leaders are people who are taking action, because change does not just happen. Change must be made to happen. And many people are always waiting for change to happen. But we know people who wait never achieve excellence. So I think those three critical things.
So vision, courage, and action being dimensions of excellence in leadership, granting credibility. Before I cross over to Nigeria, Jesse, the component I'm pushing you on is innovation, innovative leadership. I've seen innovation applied in many contexts, but not as often in leadership as in general practice of life. So how do you see innovation in this discussion of leadership, and how do you apply that in what you do?
Take your mind to Nigeria. Dr. Eddie Agbo, if I got the name correct, has developed an amazing gadget which can test whether you have malaria or not in 25 minutes. All you need to do is wee-wee or pee in it, and they can tell you. Now, why did he develop that? He developed that because one of the biggest issues that we have in Africa is malaria. And you know clearly that anytime any African has a fever, the first thing he does is to take a pill.
Yeah.
So instead of jumping to take a pill, he says, pee first before you take a pill. Now, that's an amazing innovation born out of necessity and born out of a need. Now, it's important in leadership because leadership is not about looking at yourself in the mirror. It's about turning the mirror to face the people you're leading and finding out ways of improving their lives. Now, which takes me to one of the most important things I do every day, building a business based on insight. Now, what is insight? Insight simply says that if I want to lead the cohort sitting here today, my first job is to find out what's important to them, where are we going, and map what's important to them to the direction that we are going on today. So it's very, very important for leaders to be driven by innovation. Without innovation, you can't lead people. Number two, it's been said that the needs of man are insatiable. And therefore, anytime you provide Bernard Avler with what he needs today, tomorrow he wants something different. Today we wanted SMS. Tomorrow we want internet. The following day we want Skype calls. So as the needs of man is getting completely insatiable, leadership at some point in time might be cheating the citizenry. So it's important for leadership to move behind the citizenry and get ahead of them. And the only way to do that is to innovate ahead of the people. Other than that, we will play catch up with leadership consistently, and we cannot fulfill the promise of the people.
Thank you very much. Let me now cross over to Audu, who who's a decorated entrepreneur. Audu, so in your entrepreneurial journey, did you see yourself as playing a leadership role? And if you did, can you elaborate a bit on that? Because you are quite the quintessential entrepreneur. So talk to me about how you saw yourself evolving as an entrepreneur and whether you were consciously leading or you were just responding to societal needs.
Yeah, no, I'd be lying if I said I thought I was being a leader. What I thought was that there was a problem and I saw that there was need to put a solution, and I thought, well, instead of complaining, why don't you do something about it? And I really think that that is what entrepreneurs really do. It's really about looking at the problem, finding a solution, and then, you know, scaling up that solution and spreading it out. And once you keep solving your problem, then you're in business. But I guess over time, as we began to do that, and really we started off with media and entertainment and saying, okay, so Nigeria and Africa has got loads of talented people, but there was a problem with the structure, there's a problem with how they have been managed, there's a problem with the perception. And at the time, 10, 15 years ago, if you said you were a musician or an artist or a makeup person, people would laugh at you and it looked like a joke. And we thought it was time to kind of change that perception. And I'm a lawyer by training. And so it was kind of laughed at that a lawyer would leave a stable income to start working in a field that was more for people who couldn't go to school. So I think that in that way, the leadership thing started coming out. But I think it's important to state that we're in a state where enterprise is probably one of the most important influencers when it comes to leadership. When you think about how much a Bill Gates has affected the world economy, or Warren Buffett, or Dangote, you name them, it shows that there is actually an opportunity for entrepreneurs if they take the right decision, if they have the right vision and the right purpose, to make money while impacting society in a positive way. So for me, the things that are important to me is doing business with integrity, making sure that we're creating value, making sure that we're building people, and making sure that we always put the customer first. And I think that that is the value that most people look for businesses. But when you're able to do that in a sustainable way, in a way that actually impacts people, you will see a great change in how the continent is going to be developed. And I think that that's another part that in Africa we do dearly need, sorely need. We need leaders who are thinking about the value they bring beyond the cash that goes to their bank, but what they give back to people who are their customers.
Thank you very much. That was Audu. Maikori, this is the Transition Africa Projects Leadership Factor Conference coming to you from the Alisa Hotel. My name is Bernard Abler, your moderator. And we're joined by some of the best young brains on the continent, 3 Ghanaian, 1 Kenyan, and 1 Nigerian, plowing through the murky concept of leadership as it applies to transformation in our continent. I'm going to ask one final question to each panelist before we bring the audience in. Franklin, so on my radio show, most of the times when we talk about leadership, or discuss Africa, like tomorrow, which is a holiday, most people say, Africa, our problem, our leaders. Who are our leaders? They are the politicians. I get the sense most ordinary citizens don't see themselves as leaders on the continent. Do you agree with me? And what can we do to change that? Why are there so many people on the continent who feel, unless you're an elected political officer, you're not a leader, and all I can do as a citizen is to throw my arms up in the air and complain?
Well, there's a historical aspect too. There's a historical answer. You know, on the path of independence, most of our independent African leaders decided that the vestiges of colonialism, which at the time, like it or not, if you look at the indirect rule, there were some levels of representation, at least at the table, at the political table. When leaders assumed the reins of power after independence, they almost drove everything that was called innovation in leadership and governance out through the door, and actually made it difficult for people to think creatively and in some respects think about themselves as wealth creators, as independent, free economic beings. Now, that has a way of affecting your ability to be confident and your ability to demand that the significant process of governance are not complete unless you are party to that particular enterprise. So if it was socialism, which obviously the path we took, was essentially this fraudulent, if you like, system that made it difficult for people to understand that the leader is just a servant, and that the leaders at the time were essentially telling us that they'll create nirvana, they'll create an ideal society where to each according to his needs, but at the same time, we're erecting barriers to enterprise, we're erecting all these barriers that made creative thinking, independent thinking, difficult. Saw the leadership at the time as thin gods, mini gods, indeed some of them were, by dint of some of the constitutional steps that they took. So they outlawed a lot of the citizen, should I call that, the institutions that was going to necessitate the citizens took part in the governance process well. So at the end of the day, the government was seen as a provider, became a paternalistic state, that we, most states were paternalistic. Tanzania, you just name them, which were much later replaced by coconut heads.
Which so you're giving us a historical, yes, political reason
exactly
for this. And so does that still persist today? Why do citizens today, some people were born in 1990, still don't see themselves as leaders?
Well, we somehow managed to come out of the pool, and so we do not have to come out of the
pool. I'm sorry, people are too busy stealing. Okay, to help you, I'm sorry.
Essentially, things on the political exchange.
Because you must read about what's going on over here. You must have an opinion.
Yeah, I'm going to have them to
the extent that I'll still see that their livelihoods are messy. That they actually offer you, guaranteeing you freedom of poverty. Those things still exist.
You're blaming. I'm sure some other players want to jump on. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you your own question, and then you can chip in briefly on this concept, so that will be true to the program. See, so while you deal with your view on that, it doesn't seem to me as if in this country and other parts of the continent, people hold integrity as dearly. I mean, I know in certain spaces, if a politician is found to lie, that's the end of his political career. But it appears here you can tell a non-truth and work your way around it, and people will even hail you. So why isn't integrity so demanded? But I believe you want to comment briefly on the first question.
Thank you very much. On the first thing, remember I mentioned the word transformation. A lot of times when we talk about leadership, etc., we begin looking at politicians and institutions, etc., and we forget to look at ourselves. You know, it has to start from the individual. Otherwise, we play this blame game and we never get to the bottom of it. The leaders we have rise out of the people. We are the people. And at the end of the day, for me, it's important to remember that we've created an environment where for somebody to see themselves as a leader, they think they have to have a position. I have to be president of so-and-so association, secretary, this and that. And at the end of the day, you feel you don't have a position, so you can't do anything. So long as there's another human being around you and you don't live in a bubble all by yourself, you have the capacity to influence people. That capacity is leadership. So whether you like it or not, leadership is thrust upon you. Okay. What you do with it is important, right? And I think until we look in the mirror and see ourselves and ask ourselves, I may blame the politicians for huge scandals, but I run the red light. If I'm abusing domestic, folk who work in my home, if I'm doing certain things that are not fair, they are unjust, that is good evidence of bad leadership, right? So let's not make leadership this positional, you've got to have a certain title and a certain, status. It's everybody.
But you do agree with my premise that most ordinary citizens, when we discuss leadership, the last person they think about is themselves.
Exactly. That's what we need to change.
And how do we change that?
oh, we change that by beginning to wake people up, conscientizing people. I think it's a mindset thing. I teach leadership, and that is where I start from. I ask students, you know, if you smile at a baby, a four-month-old baby, what happens? Baby smiles back. You pinch them, they'll respond.
Yeah.
That's leadership, where you have the capacity to influence people. Always remember that there's always a pair of eyes looking at you, learning from you. If we start training people very early, that look, do what is right, be honest, be just, be fair. When you do these things, you positively influence other people, and then that grows.
All right, so Franklin is looking at this from the top down, you're looking at this from the bottom up. 30 seconds on integrity. It doesn't appear to be at the heart of the leadership conversation on this continent.
Because, like I said, corruption and integrity, we need to start defining. Let me use the example of corruption. What's the definition? If I ask 10 people, they'll come up with 10, you know, definitions. Same with integrity.
Yeah.
Call it stealing. Call it cheating. Call it lying. Call it injustice. Then we begin to deal with it. If you call integrity honesty, justice, etc., then we can deal with it. So perhaps on the continent, we need to ban those two words and start looking at what it really, really is. Then we'll begin to be more conscious. Otherwise, it's this big word we throw around in discussions, but nobody ever begins to apply. So I think the challenge is application.
All right. Let me come to Raphael, and I want you to talk to me about excellence, but I'm going to link it to Franklin's point. There appears to be a lack of truly excellent people, or the critical mass of excellence that will pull everybody forward. You've excelled in your field. Why is it so difficult to be truly excellent people on the continent and drive that you need?
I remember my man telling me that you will be up there, what you down here. Sometimes we imagine that better is up there, you cannot be any down here. So if I'm leader of a cattle association in my community, that's not important. Until someday I become a big politician, I'm looking for how can I good. We need to change that mindset and realize that leadership is not only at the top. At whichever level, whichever responsibility that comes, we need to exercise leadership. The most important position is citizenry, citizenship. We must see our, because we want to improve the people that leaders can never be greater than their employees. So we are the responsibility. So as citizens, we need to start seeing our people. We have all the elected leaders. What responsibility, what action do we take to the in terms of to find excellence?
Yes.
I think there are many challenges, and I can apply for the lack of authenticity. Many people are what people believe. The second thing is, because there are many bad leaders, anyone who comes up and wants to do the wrong thing feels isolated. And so it seems like they're dying. And so if you're part of the life, you're like, no, I'm in the minority. And you know, being in the minority means that you feel a bit lonely. So everyone wants to cross over to the majority. So there's also that. The third thing is that we have fewer people who are coming up with good example and also want to bring more good example. And the issue of, you talk about coaching, mentoring, I think we are lacking that, and people are in a position better leaders. And the third thing perhaps to situations in our various country. Here you talk about, I feel like you're about Kenya.
Because really?
It seems like those scams are replicated in every country. This a big scam on youth enterprise.
Oh, fund. Really?
Just like in wow. Ghana. So it's not
I
like
think at least compare notes.
Yeah. Especially on this negative thing. So they say, how is corruption going on youth enterprise fund in Ghana? As we finalize our scam, we are going to initiate ours very soon. You know, those kind of things. So the levels of corruption and challenges facing people who want to do the right thing are so high, and so it becomes very difficult for you to succeed if you want to do excellence. And no one cares about quality of leadership anymore these days. Brilliant. People care more about titles, people care more about status, people care more about profile, people care more about what they get from positions of leadership. Leadership has become more of aspiration, not as a position for service.
Brilliant stuff. Now let me come to Jesse. So two ways of looking at innovation, which is traditional people say, either little by little, incremental, or sudden. My question to you is, how or in what areas do you think leaders should innovate on the continent to help us transform better? You gave a good example from your own job, but I want you to broaden it to leadership generally. Give us some thoughts on how we can innovate to bring the positive change Issy spoke about quicker and to make it more sustainable.
That's well. Okay, so let me start from here. Let me expand it into more like an ecosystem of a sort.
Yeah.
I know the speakers have attempted to they've spoken about leadership and they've spoken about the citizenry.
Yeah.
But I don't want to talk about leadership. So let's talk about citizenry, because the leadership is a part of the citizenry.
Mm.
Now the leaders are a reflection of who we are at the end of the day. So if the media houses start asking the right questions from the get-go, by the time we get to the top, we expect them to live in a particular way. If we start holding our MCEs and DCEs, and James had mentioned that the SRC guys are here and all, if we start holding them on the path of innovation from today, we know what we expect of them in the future. So the conversation does not start with when Benadavale today is the president of Ghana, and therefore what's the expectation of you as a person, but it starts from the very beginning. What's my expectation of you growing up today? The second important thing within the ecosystem is technology. See, technology is a very slow as today. Because of technology, the governance structure is getting flatter by the day.
Yeah.
Today, John Mahama is in my bedroom.
Yeah.
He's with you at home. All you need to do is pick your phone. If you want to tell him, you can tell him today. So the whole idea of
that, provided he read it, but I take it.
Provided he would. But the idea is that if something is trending so amazing on social media,
yeah,
and we're saying that we are happy president, if you check the top tweets in the country today, you will see that you are trending.
Mm.
If it's a bad issue about you, you will see. Now, technology is giving us such an amazing tool to be able to research and find out ways we can improve our lives. Fortunately or unfortunately, the same tool which is allowing us for progress is the same tool which is being misunderstood by many young people today. So instead of probably using social media and the power of technology to advance our lives today, we are on Snapchat, probably sending pictures, and we are on Twitter, and we are doing lots of things, and we are sharing videos, and we're doing this here in and out. The most important thing is, 2 weeks ago, I joined a group for a conversation at the British Council. It was the first time I had heard of an application called Freelancer. Now, what's Freelancer? It's a tool developed by a group of app developers. Within Freelancer, I can work for any company in Pakistan, Istanbul, Brazil, anywhere else in my house. All I need to do is state the services I can provide, put it in there, and I can find somebody who gives me a job,
wow,
pays me via Visa, and I'm sitting at home today.
Wow.
But I had to go there to find out. There are countless applications like that sitting there. But anytime we talk about the problems of Africa, we begin to look directly at the guy sitting at the castle or the presidency. And I think that if we begin to look at the guy in the mirror and start having a busy conversation that the guy in the mirror is a leader, the guy standing in front of the mirror is a citizen, how do I impact my life? That's the beginning of changing the entire ecosystem of innovation. The next thing is education.
Okay.
Now, it's important that we understand the role education plays in driving innovation, because literacy is quite important, which is why I like what the team at Ashase is doing. Their module for education, the case study approach, all those things enhances the way we govern ourselves and drive innovation. So three things for me that, to your question, that would enable us to build a stronger innovation in Africa. citizenry. You can choose to break it down into leaders and the citizen. That's one. Two, technology. It's available for us today. Use it. Three, education. We need to take ourselves through it.
Brilliant stuff from Jesse. Let me turn to Audu. You entrepreneurs find a problem, get a solution for it, and make lots of money. We have lots of problems on the continent, and I've been to Nigeria many times. Your problems are similar to ours, just bigger in scale. Give us a couple of areas that, in your reflection over the continent, you can apply entrepreneurial drive to solve in a sustainable way.
Well, I think one of the things that's really, business, SMEs drive the economy of most countries around the world, and Africa is no different. Probably one of the things that you know about Nigeria is that we're very entrepreneurial. We like to make money, and we do anything, you know, just to make sure that there's something else. Somebody had a joke once that Nigerians are like Americans. They always have two or three jobs. You know, they're always doing different things at the same time. And I think that instead of that being a joke, I think it's something that can be harnessed. There's clearly a need for people to be able to live better, earn better, and do more with what they have. Sadly, I think that the policies, even around the financial institutions around Africa, are not very general. And I'll give you a simple example. In 2008, 2009, America was going to probably want to create a concession. So I'm
Hold on. I can hear some other person.
Yeah, somebody came in, but can you hear me now? Because I can hear you clearly.
You are very clear. Keep going.
Yeah, so sorry about that. So I was saying that in 2008 and 2009, America was going through a very rough economic patch. And what the government did at that time was agree to increase some subsidies, and they put a zero interest rate for SMEs so that it could encourage businesses. And they also intervened in some critical sectors to ensure that jobs were not lost. I find that in Africa, generally, I don't think we have a policy around supporting SMEs in the proper way. So it is not just about starting a business. It's really about sustaining a business. 60 to 70% of businesses that start off die within 5 years. And it's not because they don't have a good idea or, you know, a product. It's that they do not have the skills. They do not have the understanding. And they are not being educated continuously. So I think before we even go to the role of entrepreneurship, some of us have been lucky that we've been able to make tangible growth in the sectors that we've chosen, but many more will not. Some will not because they're not talented, not because they do not have the resources, is that in terms of the human capital, it is zero. Now, I'd also like to comment on something the previous speakers also said, which is about the responsibility of leadership, because many people think it's easy to always blame the next man, you know, and we talk about, I mean, Nigeria, half of the time they say, oh, civil servants are corrupt or politicians are corrupt. And I'm always asking the question, so these civil servants, which country are they from? Aren't they Nigerians as well? You know, when they want ordinary people like you and I, and what changed? Their position changed. But the truth is that the institutions were not strong enough to ensure that the individuality of a person wouldn't suppress the system. And that's what we failed to do as well. So I think that if you think about the institutionalization of even the business sector in Africa, it will change a lot. Now remember that the first need of a person is to eat. And if you work, you cannot eat. The government cannot provide all the jobs. So it's clear that entrepreneurship is the only way by which things can be sustained. So my view, I mean, just to wrap up without taking too much time, is that there is a need for us to encourage entrepreneurs, but there needs to be a sustainable environment. And that includes access to funding, that includes the training, that includes schools, education, where people can actually learn how to run businesses profitably. And then you also need the human capital who can help you, because most businesses are very one-man type businesses. There are no succession planning, so you start up a company by yourself, so it's Audu and Sons. And when you die, that's the end. You may not have a son that takes over the business. But when you start thinking about a corporate structure for your business, and you think about bringing in partners and shareholders and a proper board and all those other things that help to keep a business running, then and only then are you adding value so that your company will be there in 30, 40 years' time, employing more people, increasing the value it gives to society, and hopefully making a name for itself as well.
Thank you very much. Audu Maikori is joining us from Nigeria, Google Hangout, using technology. As Jesse said, this is the Leadership Factor Conference coming through from the Alisa Hotel. We're discussing leadership within five broad focus areas: citizenship, integrity, excellence, innovation, and entrepreneurship. And we're turning to you shortly to pick your comments or your questions. We have mics at the extreme ends of the hall. You do not need to get up. If you want to ask a question, indicate by show of hand, the mic will be brought to where you're seated, and then you can ask your question. I'm going to take a final comment from Franklin, who wants to jump to something somebody said, and then I'll come to the question. So, Franklin.
We should be careful about democratization of the concept of leadership. The fact of the matter is that it is true that citizens actually elect leaders. But in actual fact, leaders are then given the opportunity to prosecute a particular mandate. On the continent, almost every democratic leader, as it were, does what he has to do or she has to do in order to win the next election. That's nothing to do about you, which is why there are economic indices, there are political indices. Mo Ibrahim doesn't do a Mo Ibrahim Prize for citizens of Africa. He does it for leaders, which is why he holds back when he feels there's no effective leader. I think the question you posed was misunderstood by my co-panelist.
Okay.
You wanted a construct within which the reasons for which people are not able to rise up.
Yes.
And as I'm suggesting to you, there is not a democratization of the concept. We have economic indices as we speak. In fact, I recall some time ago when even then, young people like Bright Simmons and Salom Brantier, and some of us pushed the M-pedigree idea. It was stonewalled in this country.
Yeah.
You know who actually made it happen in Rwanda? We did a presentation in Geneva. Kagame was sitting there. He called his health minister, called Bright, make sure this works in 60 days. That's leadership.
Wow.
So let's not democratize leadership at all and suggest that,
yes,
well, you have to look yourself in the mirror. No, I pay a tax, I elect somebody. He needs to work within the framework and deliver development.
Exciting stuff, Franklin, Cudjoe. And I guess the other panelists want to jump in, but it's a good place. I remember the June 3 disaster, flood and flooding, and the refrain from the politicians was, we are all at fault. We are all to blame. I get your feeling. But do you have comments? Leadership in a very murky way. I hope it's making sense. If you have any question or comment, indicate by show of hand, we'll bring the mic to you. Mention your name, and then you go straight to the question.
Okay, thank you. My name is Christian Atu, and I'd like to add to what Franklin said earlier, and excuse me, the name again.
AC
said, you know, you asked a question about leadership either being an individual. Do we even see ourselves as leaders in the first place? And I came across this definition of democracy by someone who said democracy is a legal system of choosing people we can blame for our own problems. I don't know where he got that definition, but maybe I'm sure he saw that in Africa. So that's where maybe...
Can you repeat that? I like it. Democracy is what?
It's a legal means of selecting people we can blame for our own problems.
Wow. Love that.
Yeah. But then... adding to what he said, you know, we have to look at leadership, as you said, like from an individual perspective. Leadership is not about position. Leadership is about what you do. It's about the transformation you bring. It's not holding a position. No, it is what you do with what you have. So leadership is about solving problems. It's about identifying the need in society and going all out to solve them. But the economic and governance system we have in place now is a kind of system that prevents individual leadership. Let me put it in that way. Because before you can come out as a leader, as an individual, you have to either be in one political system or sideline with some leadership role or something before you be given the opportunity.
So you're tending to agree more with Franklin.
Yes, because you could have an innovative idea. You may need alliances or something, and you go through a very bureaucratic system, and you end up giving up. We have people who want to come up with great things in Ghana, But the system is so hard and tough that it's okay. So difficult to come out
Thank
with.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, so I think that is to add to what Franklin is saying.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We'll go to the extreme.
Yes.
Your extreme right. Yes.
Good evening. Good evening. My name is Stephen Asiedu. And I think I want to say thank you to Franklin for that wonderful point. In fact, you spoke my mind in your last words. I want to add to that by saying that, you know, we are all talking about leadership at the individual level, leadership at the top level. But I think there's one thing we all miss. There's something fundamentally wrong with our culture. Something fundamentally wrong with our upbringing. It's supposed to influence how we relate and how we do business. The sense of honesty in us, in our culture, it's missing. And let me just give you a classical example, then I'll just conclude. In our various homes, when your brother is wrong, maybe he crossed a red light, and then he's arrested. You happen to know somebody at the police headquarters. You are quick to call for an intervention. So there, you do not allow the law to work. So all of us, I think Amico Beauty, we have contributed to allowing this culture persist. Then we turn back and blame leadership, when indeed we do not even encourage them to apply the laws. Then let's come to business and let's talk about, you know, leadership creating an enabling environment for individuals and entrepreneurs to flourish. The environment we have is not enabling, one, because even the businessman is looking at how to cut corners, because the regulators have made it so difficult for him to do things the right way. If he wants to do the right way, like you want a passport, you may have to wait for close to a month or two. But if you're able to pay around, you get it faster. So the systems do not support honesty, and we ourselves have not been brought up to accept honest people. So until we begin that change from the cultural point, from the upbringing, we can begin to see some change in our leadership, some change in our own lives, and maybe business can be very, you know, attractive for individuals and then for entrepreneurs.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you very much.
Gentleman on the left. Yes, you just rise. We'll bring the mic to you.
Okay, thank you very much. So when Dr. S.C. Ansah was talking about integrity, she said something about trust and credibility. So I'd just like to ask, what in credibility requires putting the best interest of people at heart, nonetheless giving them very true information? What is the extent of information to be relayed in cases where such information is sensitive and probably injurious to the public interest? And on entrepreneurship, I would like to comment on the stereotype of entrepreneurship. Like in Africa, most of us think that entrepreneurship is some kind of plan B for unsuccessful people. So how do we change this kind of perception?
Thank you very much. While the Q&A is going on, I'll call my co-moderator, Seth Tando, who is the founder of Leadership Ghana, to take his seat, the hot seat, as the moderator. There's a part two of this panel discussion coming up. Round of applause for Seth Tando, please. So there was a skew of the suited hippies on the right and the African people on the left. So he's come to rebalance the scale towards the African side. So Seth will take over after the Q&A. We also want to acknowledge the representative of the president, the former president of the Republic of Ghana, John Agyekum Kuffour, Mr. Frank Agyekum. He's here with us. Let's acknowledge the president. Thank you. And I am usually advised not to do this if I don't have a script, but I think I see the Zimbabwe ambassador to Ghana in the house. Let's acknowledge their presence, madam. Thank you very much for being here. We'll take a couple more questions, and then we'll hear from the former president, after which the panel will continue with Seth. So if any more questions, yes, sir, in the front. Oh, okay, somebody beat you to it, yes.
Hello, I'm Nicholas from Challenges Worldwide.
Good.
I want to lament a little bit about leadership. Frankly, don't you think because of the kind of politics we do in Ghana, that patronage politics that affects leadership? Maybe in Ghana, I heard an MP saying you have to get more than 500,000 cedis before you can contest for that position. Don't you think if you don't have money, you can't sustain the patronage politics? If you get my point.
Thank you. I'm hoping the panelists are noting the questions directed at them and then set to allow you to respond in the next part. Are there any more questions? So, yes, sir.
My name is Edmund. My question directs.
Your mic is not working. Can you fix that for me, please? Yes.
What role are institutional, educational institutions are expected to play in inculcating the culture of leadership in a youth? And you also mentioned about certain qualities of good leaders. Can you expatiate on some of the other aspects? You mentioned honesty and others. What other qualities should good leaders have? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I guess we have time for two extra questions. I'll go to the lady on the extreme right.
Hi, my name's Hannah. I'm from the UK and also with Challenges Worldwide. I have a more specific question for the panel, and that's kind of, in a world where the majority of leadership positions are dominated by men, what can or should African countries do in order to encourage young women and young girls into these kind of leadership roles?
Thank you very much indeed. And our final question from the back. Okay, you have the mic already? All right, go ahead.
My name is Peter Bueno. And I have a position on leadership and how Africa can progress when it comes to issues of leadership. And I want to get the position from the panelists with respect to my point of view. I believe that the main problem that we are facing has to do with the structures. I think we don't have working structures in Africa. So when you even have a good leader, someone who has the integrity, someone who has the innovation and whatever it takes to get up there, the systems wouldn't support the person, and the person ends up turning back. So I believe, or I think, that we have to focus together as a people to build working structures that we can all rely on. And then from that point of view, we can have Franklin's point supported. We can hold people accountable. And we will be able to succeed in holding them accountable because the structures that we have built ourselves will support it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for all your questions. I believe there will be more opportunities for you in the course of the program. This is the Leadership Factor Conference, a Transition Africa project, and it's coming to you from the Alisa Hotel. We're grateful to our sponsors, Peace FM, Rightel, Joy FM, Innovate, Alisa Hotel, and TEDx Accra. Before Seth takes over the second part of the panel discussion, we're privileged to have the special representative of our former president, His Excellency John Agyekum Kuffour, in the person of Mr. Frank Agyekum. And I want to call him to come and deliver the keynote address on behalf of the former president. Please welcome him with a round of applause.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Mr. Chairman, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Before I start, I wish to bring you the deepest apologies of His Excellency John Agyekum Kuffour, former president, who really would have wished to be with us here today. But I believe that his apologies have been already extended to you. Just to add that, you know, when you are getting to 80 years, your body does not always respond to your desires. So he's not here with us, and that's why I've come to read his speech for him. Mr. Chairman, the name of the organizers of this conference, Transition Africa, at once conveys the impression of awareness that our continent is still in motion and is here to get to its appointed destiny, which to me is to be in the mainstream of world affairs. Africa has been described by one world leader as the last frontier of human development, and Transition Africa appears to be aware of this and is prepared to tackle the problem head on. Mr. Chairman, leadership arguably is the single most important aspect in human development, as it transforms invariably and provides a spark for transformation of any given social system. A leader must first be seized with the aspirations of his people and not only have a high sense of determination to succeed. The people's aspiration must fuel the leader's ambition and foresight to lead them to achieve these goals. A good leader brings good results. A bad leader brings bad results. Down the millennia, history is replete with examples of great leaders whose image appear larger than life. Mention could be made of Alexander the Great of the Greek Empire, Julius Caesar of the Roman Empire, and the far-reaching influence they have across the world. We could also talk about Charles de Gaulle and his impact on the modern French society, Lee Kuan Yew and the transformation of Singapore from a tiny, poor country with hardly any natural resource into a first-class world society in a space of about 30 years. Same can be said of Deng Xiaoping in opening up the economy of China and turning it into the second biggest power in the world today. Félix Houphouët-Boigny of our neighboring Côte d'Ivoire, who overtook our dear Ghana as the largest cocoa producing country in the world in the 1960s, and that country has never looked back since. And our own Kwame Nkrumah for his immense impact on the liberation struggle in Africa, which then led to the Africa becoming independent in various forms. And also there's Nelson Mandela for his great spirit of forgiveness, which contributed to shatter the iron grips of apartheid in South Africa and create a rainbow society of one citizenship. The list goes on. Of course, I cannot fail to mention Jesus Christ, the greatest leader of all times, whose influence throughout the world lives forever by espousing the universality of mankind through negating the ancient Judaic difference between the Jew and the Gentile. Mr. Chairman, although current Africa has had its bright spots in history, it is obvious that, on the whole, it has not had the leadership question well sorted out, and hence its present predicament. What Africa needs is good leadership that has been well nurtured to direct socio-economic development with vision and a missionary zeal to tackle the myriad problems facing the continent in a prioritized order, without compromising or sacrificing on the dignity of the citizenship. Africa is a continent of 56 nations, most of which were subjugated in one way or the other under foreign domination. The leaders that appeared on the political scene after independence about 60 years ago were driven with the spirit of political liberation. Not many of them had been well prepared for the complexities of managing a modern nation state or dealing with the intricate international transactions that came with it. With independence came the accomplishment of their singular goal of liberation, more or less. Unfortunately, though, these leaders began to behave like their departed colonial masters and started to lord it over their people. They also assumed the mentality of the pre-colonial African kings and queens and saw themselves as fathers and mothers of their nations, who then could not be challenged. Most of them believed it was their divine right to assume the echelons of power in society and therefore thought of themselves as leaders for life. One challenged them at one's own peril. Faced with steering the delicate and complex challenges of nation building in the unfriendly international Cold War era, both of these leaders failed many of the African states, and many of them began to flounder the economy's worsening. A combination of mismanagement and arbitrary rule saw a rapid dissipation of the resources of their countries and led to hardships and unrest. The military used the unrest and the hardships and the discontent of the people to shoot their way to power. Almost to a man, all the African post-colonial strongmen were overthrown in military coups in the 1960s, paving the way for the era of the men in boots. From the mid-1960s to the mid-1990s, the African political scene was a turbulent one, with rampant military coups, each successive deepened the economic and social woes of the continent. The soldiers fared no better as they continued with the arbitrariness of those they had overthrown, as well as further plundering the resources of the continent. In the process, infrastructure, education, health, sanitation, housing, and the private sector were not well developed or expanded. The net effect of this was that African countries still kept the economic structures bequeathed to them by colonial powers as producers of raw materials for sale on the international markets for prices they had no control over, and importers of all finished goods. It was not until the early 1990s, following the end of the Cold War, that many African countries tried to relaunch themselves on and embark on the road to democratic rule. The use of the ballot box was as a means of governance was further strengthened by the Constitutive Act of the African Union, which mandated the use of the ballot box as the preferred means of governance and ensured that free enterprise and freedom of speech thrived on the continent. Africa needs to be on this path in order to mainstream itself into international governance, as plurality in governance systems now seems to be the order of the day. Mr. Chairman, mankind today is at the cusp of great and phenomenal information age and knowledge revolution, which is impelling the transformation of and shepherding all nations and peoples into the perceived global village, the home of which is increasingly and rapidly becoming shared values and well-being for all mankind. These tenets became instituted through the establishment of the UN and also the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The trend of global politics and humanity in governance launched the notion in evolving global citizenship. This evolution has been captured and accelerated through the two epochal resolutions of 2015 on climate change and sustainable development by the United Nations. Arguably, these two resolutions have received the largest endorsement ever in the history of the world body so far. The fact that both events took place in 2015 marks that year as a watershed year in the affairs of nations of the world. The imperatives of the times make the impact of climate change overarching. No country is exempt from its devastating consequences. And the perception is that all in the world should pull together to save our planet. The world must move quickly to seek to arrest and mitigate the rise of global temperatures to under 2% degrees above pre-industrial levels by the middle of the century. Else, life as we know it today may come to an end. Towards this end, governments around the world, corporate entities, philanthropic organizations, non-government organizations, and many other stakeholders took part to express commitment to the Paris Climate Agreement last December. In order for the world community to be able to meet the necessary targets set in the climate agreements, there is a need for transparency, accountability, and sincerity on the part of all nations to the commitments they made. There is a need for robust investments in green technologies to ensure resilience to the climate change menace. And this must be extended through the multilateral organizations to developing countries to avoid continued greenhouse emissions from both the developed and developing countries. To this end, the developed world should assume their responsibility to contribute with the agreed funding that needed for the agency to ensure that all necessary technology transfers to the poorer nations in the fight against climate change are met. Nations of the world should endeavor to keep to their intended nationally determined contributions to the climate change adaptation and mitigation efforts. In this way, developing countries must also keep up to the promise they made in making sure that they keep their environment clean and avoid pursuing the path of development that developed countries have undergone and that is bringing us all the problems we face in the environmental climate today. Sustainable development, the other major preoccupation of global governance, is born out of the need to join international development efforts with the efficient management of the world's resources. At the turn of this century, the world community elected to tailor international development under the Millennium Development Goals, a set of 10 targets for addressing extreme poverty in all its forms, including diseases, conflicts, and etc. At the end of the period in 2015, many targets had been achieved at varying levels, and many more had also been missed. The 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, a set of 17 Sustainable Development Goals, subsumed the Millennium Development Goals and is now the new development paradigm to fight global poverty, inequality, justice, and tackle climate change by the year 2030. The further strengthening of multilateralism in world affairs is seen in how the international community rallies together in times of disaster, as seen in the migration crisis, or during acts of terrorism, or in financial crisis. No longer is one nation the champion of all. Africa, with its burgeoning population, set to be the biggest in the world by the next century, will also have the highest number of youths. While this could be a big advantage, it also poses a big challenge. If this huge, expectant workforce is not put to productive use through education and modern skill acquisition, the continent will be in grave danger indeed, as job avenues as we know them today may no longer exist. Rapid development in technology and science soon ensure that the ways we do things become moribund, and even before we master them, new ones are invented. In this way, our youth must be able to master the transformative trends and embrace the universal need for sustainable development that works for all peoples and for all times. To empower the youth to meet this challenge calls for informed and purposive partnership between governments, private sector, academia, civil society, organizations, and many more. Time is of essence, and also deep appreciation of geopolitics in the global market is also critical. This will drive and facilitate the right policy formulation, enlightened regulatory mechanisms, and smart negotiating skills in the partnership. Africa must have to leapfrog into the mainstream of globalization. This will enable our leaders of today and the future to stand equal to the task of efficient management of the resources of our planet into the long term, in order to meet the increasing demands of the ever-growing population of the world community. The youth of today should be mindful that economic governance must go in tandem with environmental governance, as well as good and inclusive representative governance. This is the surest guarantor for the sovereignty of the people. It is governance that meets aspirations and needs and challenges of the citizen. And it is this way that I believe that Africa, which has been termed the last frontier of development, would be able to mainstream itself and take its rightful place in the world community. Thank you very much.
Indeed, we thank President Kuffour for this wonderful and inspiring message, and it brings up a lot of points that I think we are going to be looking at. First of all, thank you for your questions. I'm Seth Tando. I'm representing Leadership Ghana. And I'll be taking the conversation in a little bit of a different direction. But first, let's look at the questions that came up. Hannah had a question about women leaders. Franklin, if I can start with you. In terms of citizen leadership, do you notice any variances between the sexes on the ground? Are women culturally sensitized to be leaders, or is there still a shyness on the part of women becoming leaders amongst particular educational groups, for example?
Well, if you are to go by my definition of trying to democratize the concept of leadership, then it presupposes that women indeed are the primordial leaders in our communities, because in any case, they take care of a significant part of our livelihoods from childhood all the way. They essentially keep us in line, and they do in communities that are quite peasantry or substance based. You find out that women indeed are the breadbaskets.
So, and again, in terms of demographics, they tend to be more than us. I mean, the only reason why this issue about the girl child of women have become a topical issue is because of the economic system we operate. I mean, the governance system makes it somehow, I tend to take a very pedantic view that we would cease talking about women, the exclusion of women, the, if you like, the sidelining of women, if indeed everybody had comfortable 3 square meals a day. Essentially, what I'm trying to suggest is that if the economic wherewithal was well organized, like in other societies, they don't talk about women who are not able, who are not given the opportunity to bring themselves up. It's actually just a self-limitation, which makes it difficult for them to come up. Was it someone who suggested recently that why do women keep saying they are in the minority? They actually are a significant majority because they are more than us, and collectively they do better. So clearly,
we always hear about women are the breadwinners, etc., etc. Does that translate into actual leadership? Because, well, for example, a simple thing like family planning. I mean, Melinda Gates is always talking about contraception, and it's women who are doing it sometimes behind the backs of their husbands because they want to control the size of the family. Is that leadership or is that something else?
If we are to understand that leadership also involves taking initiative and also being protective of your turf, if you like, then I suspect that women are indeed smarter. The reasons for which, if you have a chauvinist society where the men would take advantage of them without necessarily giving them their say, they take on the initiatives. And Melinda Gates is right. They take on the initiative to go for these.
Okay, so a kind of soft leadership.
Well, it's a kind of soft leadership. But in the broader scheme of things, I tend to disagree that there is a construct, really, that is preventing women, apart from the cultural things. All these things can be solved, indeed, if you have a very organized system of governance that makes it easier for people to think about other things rather than...
We are pressed for time. Raphael, is the situation different in your country, or is it a similar thing to what he's describing?
I think it's more or less the same. Over the years, I think women have been deprived of the various enablers that can make them also be in spaces of leadership.
So,
for example, we have what we call the devolved system of governance, which we introduced in 2010 for the first time. And you realize that the requirement for you to be a governor, head of a devolved unit, requires some level of education, it requires some level of economic empowerment, which most of the women in certain areas had not attained, or rather could not achieve. So for us to be able to have many more women in positions of leadership, we also need to think of what are the various barriers and how can we help women break these barriers and how can we provide them with the enablers, if it is education, if it is resources, if it is the cultural norms that continue to weigh down on women, how can we also tackle that?
Thank you. AC, you are probably an obvious person to answer this question, but very briefly, because we have to go to the question about what educational institutions can be doing about leadership. So very briefly on the women's issue, and then let's move to the educational institutions.
If I remember correctly, thank you. If I remember correctly, Hannah was asking, what do we do or what don't we do? Well, starting early and raising children in the home, not with the gender lenses on, all right? So that's one. And then two, we need to balance our interventions where, let's say we miss the opportunity to start early. You can't talk about say no to sex, teenage pregnancy, etc., and talk to just one group, the girls, and leave out the boys. You can't talk about domestic violence, we need to stop this, etc., and talk to the women and leave the men out. One big problem for me is when we marginalize women's issues and, you know, it's women's this, women's that. No, force it on the table. Let's talk about leadership and let's talk about, you know, issues openly without human issues, without always putting the gender spin. And that is when we'll begin to get the other, you know, sides more involved.
So can educational institutions play a key role in that?
Definitely. And I think it's the family and our educational institutions. And, you know, in our communities, we socialize children. That's how we learn about gender roles and all that. So it's not just academic institutions, but
institutions in the communities, you know, right. How we raise people and socialize them to think about roles.
Right.
And just one quick one. I think how we also position and stigmatize men who tend to be advocates and men who tend to be feminists, you know, and pushing the agenda for women. And we label them, we stigmatize, and so it becomes this uncomfortable space.
Yeah.
Thank you. It's interesting because talking about male and female issues, I think the whole issue of identity is missing from this discussion. And I have a personal theory that I want to bring because I want to take this into a more social sphere. A gentleman at the back talked about culture. You know, I believe that Africans at the moment, we're going through a sort of identity crisis because in the past, we defined ourselves more of from the outside in. We got our belonging from who we were in society, who we are associated with. And now we are being told that with democracy, it's what is inside. It's what you can say. It's you being the individual. In the village setup, you did things for people, and there was a kind of silent IOU where this person tells you weed his farm, and then later on, you go back, and if you need something from him. So it builds dependency. But when it comes to the capitalist system, you are telling people that no, each person now has to act as an individual and develop themselves from the inside. But a lot of our society is now still focused on how the thing looks rather than what's actually going on beneath the surface. And these are really ingrained cultural things. So talking about innovation and excellence, how do you bring out these points in the face of these cultural norms? Anyone, Jesse?
Okay. So the question is, how do you bring out?
In the face of this sort of identity crisis where in the olden days, it's who we are known for, to be in society, so the for sure aspect, but now it's more of what's happening, justify your inclusion in the democracy and in the capitalist free market system to become an entrepreneur, yeah.
See, it goes back to the earlier point that I was making. And my assumption is this, that if we're talking about, let me just take a step back to what Franklin said earlier, and then I'll come back to this. If we're talking about party political leadership, then okay, tick the box on voting for a president, mm-hmm. holding him accountable, mm-hmm. kicking him out if he doesn't perform. Mm-hmm. But if it's a concept of leadership, it is far bigger than seeing an individual sitting on a chair at the Flagstaff House. That's completely different. Mm-hmm. Now, so which is the point that I wanted to differentiate. And I wanted to bring that point into one of the points that one of the guys had made at the back. He'd made a point that for us to be able to change culturally, change the society, we need to change our cultural setting, which is the individualism that you're speaking about now. One, I grew up in a setting where any action that I had to take, the first thing that might be told to me is "Kwame Fiye," or "Kwame, be careful." So even from an upbringing perspective, we have not had the concept of entrepreneurship even ingrained in our minds. Mm-hmm. We've been, frankly, let me just finish.
Yes,
let me just finish.
Land. Yes.
Because I'm speaking about from an external family perspective to a nucleus family perspective. Mm-hmm. So we have grown from a system where instead of over-focusing on the extended family, mm-hmm. we are now focusing much more on the nuclear family today. And individuals are now fighting for their share of the national cake, which is what is leading us to clear innovations today. So today, if I need to think clearly of an idea that might be mind-boggling, it's me. How do I use the power of technology to enhance my life and people?
But even before you get to technology, how do you overcome the mindset of where you are being warned as a child, be careful, don't stick out of the crowd, and now you are being asked to innovate?
First one is in it. See, I was on a panel at the British Council the last time, and they were having a conversation about bridging the skills gap.
Right.
And the first panelist made a very important point. Mm-hmm. He said, the skills gap is an educational problem. The second panelist said, the skills gap is an individual problem. Right. Now, between the two of them, they are right. Because even if the skills gap is entrenched within the educational system, the individual has a responsibility to be willing to face the challenges and overcome them.
Yes.
So even if the society was so laissez-faire to the extent that you had everything that you wanted as an individual,
So whose responsibility is it? Is it the leader supposed to promote that mindset, or you as
both? It has to be both. Mm-hmm. See, I don't care what the leader tells me. Mm-hmm. I don't care what John Mahama says to me, or the Nigerian president says to me. The most important thing is, what do I make of the environment being created? Mm-hmm. If the environment created is great enough for me to take advantage of it opportunistically, and I don't, it's not a leader's issue, it's my issue.
Yes.
If the environment is terrible enough, mm-hmm. then I need to hold the leader accountable for that terrible mess created.
So we're getting into a chicken and egg sort.
Exactly. So,
Come in briefly.
See, just by the stroke of an election, the senior high school system was changed from 3 years to 4 years. Whose fault is that? No, I'm just giving, it's a great question I need to ask. Whose fault is that? We have polytechnics in this country. Instead of focusing on technical education to ensure that we build the critical middle level manpower, we decided to do what? Upgrade them to technical universities so that they can continue to run grammar courses. Whose fault is that? It's not my fault, but I have to be part of the education system. Do I set up my own school? Do I have the wherewithal? Do I probably run a private school for the poor so that I try to get my own alternative education? How many people can do that?
But Franklin, doesn't that bring us back to the same issue of, if we were taught to stand up for ourselves, yes. people power would come in and, it's my school, I am being educated, it's my future. You are in power for 4 years, 8 years, whatever, and then you leave behind the mess or the opportunity for me. So why don't I feel that I have a say?
Your say is only up to the point that you can vote on the ballot. You can talk about it, but the decision has been taken on your behalf.
Isn't that a very limited view, that if we don't do it through voting, there's no other way?
No, that's what I'm saying. You can say for all you care. Unfortunately, though, when the decisions are taken in parliament, the same people you said you've elected to represent you. So anyhow you look at it, the system messes you up. That is why you need to talk about these issues. I am not for democratizing leadership. I pay a tax. You do the work. If you don't do, I criticize you. You've got to deal with it. And I keep saying, we keep going back again. This whole idea of a constitutional crisis, for instance, and I had one guy ask a question about the structures actually limiting us. At the end of the day, you ask yourself, what does the legacy leaders have to leave? And I suspect that is what we ourselves have to be asking ourselves as well. Independently, we can do that.
But what about the question of accountability? Is there accountability in Africa?
Well, that is exactly why we're having this conversation, right? Mm-hmm. The unfortunate issues really is that we may be accountable to ourselves in our individual homes. And I like the analogy of family, nuclear family, taking decisions by themselves. And it's not selfish. It's the sign of the times. And let's not believe for once that colonial or pre-colonial Africa did not have...
But when Obama came here in 2008, he said we don't need actually strong men, we need strong institutions. Has anything changed in the 8 years?
I suspect we need both, really. You need strong institutions and need strong
men. All right, we have less than 10 minutes to go in this section. So I just want to, let's look at positive examples of, in each of you, look at positive examples of models locally or abroad that we can talk about that promotes what you're talking about. So for example, if you're talking about citizen leadership, can you give us an African model that has really worked that can leave us with a positive taste in our mouths as we are leaving?
Well,
briefly.
I would suggest that the construct of our citizen leadership is framed in a particular manner where some people are getting some kind of, I will not call it regimental training, but some sort of a laissez-faire training where they learn this concept by themselves. So there are schools. There's a leadership academy run by a guy called Fred Swanika. There is the African Leadership Initiative, which I think every leader must actually go through. But it's a leader and actually runs the same program. And I think we have excellent programs like that that I suspect we can go through to teach people. I seriously think leaders, as we have them, must go through some of these curriculum that have been developed. Otherwise,
so it should be taught.
I think it should
you
be.
You don't leave it to chance. Yeah. Okay. AC, integrity is such, as we've said, very blurred, very fuzzy, very soft. Can you give us a concrete example of how to teach it?
So one of the things that I teach at Ashesi, and I was going to actually give an example. I'll still do that because it's connected. When I think of an example of a good leader, when I think of integrity, honesty, justice, all those things, I think of my boss, Dr. Patrick Ewa. And in terms of teaching, yes, we should be intentional about teaching integrity. Can it be taught? Yes, you can teach it. Can it be learned? Yes. But it doesn't mean that everybody will pick up the same, you know, with the same intensity. And how do you teach that? I teach that through questions, a lot of reflection. I feel a lot of times we're quick to speak, quick to act, but we don't think and process enough. A lot of what we need to see in leadership will come from personal resolutions, where I have resolved that no matter what, I am going to do what is right. Somebody asked a question earlier. So if there's information that we can't share because of national security or whatever, and you're saying we should be honest at all costs, transparency means I come and I tell you, you know what, you're asking me this question, I do have an answer, but at this point, I cannot share it with you. That is transparency. You know, so can we teach integrity not in a cerebral way? You can't teach leadership in a cerebral way where it's just learn theories, etc. No. Challenge people to apply it to their lives. That's where the transformation begins.
Okay. Thank you, AC. Raphael, in your area and in your country and in your parts of Africa, your personal experience or someone you know in your own society, give us an example of what has really worked on the ground.
Okay, two examples. One is the fact that, you know, values are not necessarily learned. They are absorbed. And today we expect the younger generation to be a better generation, yet they're seeing what adults are doing. Yes. Someone who earns a paltry $3,000, maybe $300, is living in a mansionette, is driving a very state-of-the-art car. Then, and young people see this and they say, where did he get the rest of the money to buy all this? So they absorb those things. So I think we need to have many more positive examples for leadership. And two, in terms of programs, I think we need to come up with more local programs. Look at what Obama has been able to do with the Young African Leaders Initiative. Unfortunately, because those are initiatives that should emanate from Africa, but we're waiting for people from outside to come up with some of these very noble initiatives. So I think YALI would be a good program, but unfortunately it's not emanating from
Africa. Right. Okay. Interesting. Thank you. Audu, is Audu still with us?
Yes, I am.
You are very good. Sorry to have left you out after this point, but please tell us, what do you think? Can you give us some positive examples of what really works in your field of entrepreneurship?
Maybe I'll just talk generally about I'm sure you've heard the foundation. They're doing some things with encouraging young people to start up their businesses. They train them and then they give them grants. I think there's much more that can be done, but I think that is one of the biggest so far, and it's spread across Africa. There are one or two other private initiatives. For the lady, somebody was asking about how women can be empowered. There's a program called She Leads Africa. I don't know if you've heard of it, but it's started by actually a Ghanaian lady and a Nigerian lady as well, who are taking their mission around the world. They've been to South Africa and parts of Kenya and Nigeria as well. All they're trying to do is just teach women leadership skills and enterprise and give them the tools, and then also kind of connect them. Successful candidates get a cash award and a funding for whatever project they're doing. In fact, one of them I ran into not too long ago out there in New York, and what she was doing was a shoe company that was offered the training and the experience she got from She Leads Africa. But I just want to round up by saying that I think that the role of women cannot be overemphasized, simply because women live longer than men. If we don't empower the women, your children are going to suffer. So I think it's quite important that we take those steps to ensure that our women are also trained. And after we marry them, they should continue to have a career, because one of the most difficult things, I think, is a woman who's left her job,
left a career, taking care of children, and then she loses a husband, and then she's not back to square one because she has not built up those skills. The second thing is that women are better multitaskers, and they have a means of handling everything almost at the same time. So it goes without saying that there's a need to encourage more female entrepreneurs, empower them, enrich them. And the final thing is really they're better managers of money. So if I keep money with my wife, I'm sure nothing's going to happen. But if I give it to my friend, he'll probably spend it on his wife or whatever it is. So I think it's quite crucial that we look at those means of transferring those skills, not just by sex, but even as businesses. Personally, what we're doing as a company ourselves is we take on interns on a regular basis. Every year, we take in a couple of interns into the company and we teach them about how to run the business. And we take them around different parts of the company just to give them some skills and something that they can relate to. But ultimately, the most important thing for entrepreneurship is not just about starting a business, really about building and sustaining that business. And I'll really make a strong advocacy for more business schools in Africa so that people can learn those skills. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Awudu. I think we found a feminist in Nigeria. There's at least one we know. All right, Jesse, please give us a brief positive example and then your closing remarks, and we'll have a few more closing remarks and then we'll be done.
So I have basically two people in Africa, Bright Simmons, and it's a lady in Kenya, I think Jamila Abbas. Jamila worked on something called MFARM, which is a tool which enables the economy to grow very poor farmers and make them very commercially viable. So it's a way of connecting them to a much bigger opportunity, giving them advice through the power of technology. Bright Simmons, we know exactly what his story is, the big connection between drug or fake drugs and your healthcare. And we know the number of awards that he's won. Now, when I follow the passion of some of these great leaders, and I'm calling them leaders because these are people who are putting innovation at the forefront of Africa's development. So it's quite important that we can follow their life stories and make examples of them. So these are two clear people on the continent who are inspiring me every day to be able to gear towards the development for Africa. And I'm hoping that the leadership at the very, very, very top will be able to learn from the leadership behind in driving a clear agenda for Africa. My last point is something interesting that I chanced on just about 2 weeks ago in Canada, where so far as research and innovation is concerned, businesses which invest in research and innovation can get a rebate on their research and innovation, clearly, up to almost about 30% or to a value of about $3 million, Canadian dollars. Now, why is this important? It's important because when young entrepreneurs within Africa or Ghana, for instance, decide to invest in innovation, right, and they know very well that they might get a rebate on the innovation, then the guys who are invested, the guys who are being funded by the angel funds and all, would have a clear mind in finding resources to grow the economy. Right. And that's part of the leverage that we actually need. So I'm a strong believer in leadership, not just at the very, 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 very top, but I'm a strong believer in leadership within to the top, so we can collectively lift the economy together. That's my final submission.
Excellent. Final words, very briefly.
Final word is that leadership is important. Africa's problem is leadership, and we really, really need to fix that. But we must not just look at leadership at the top, like you said, we must look at leadership at the very basic level, family, community. Back in Kenya, I founded what they call the Emerging Community Leaders, where we are trying to promote young support and connect young people who are playing leadership roles in their communities, because these are going to be leaders in the country or even in the continent tomorrow. But they need capacity, they need support, and we need to invest in them.
They need support, they need investment. AC, your last word.
I think sometimes we talk about leadership and we forget about followership. Life is full of cycles. At some point, you're playing a prime leadership role. Other times, you're a follower. Being a follower also comes with responsibility. So one, we need to be able to speak truth to power. We need to be able to hold our leaders to account, and that is good followership. Two, leadership for me is all about transformation. So whoever you are, wherever you find yourself, focus on what you need to do to bring about positive transformation. And even if the systems around you are not enabling systems, figure out how to pilot. Ashesi is a pilot, it's an experiment. Try something small, see if it works. If it works, you scale up and people can learn from it. And I think until we begin to look at solutions as something we can generate, we'll forever be helpless and think the answer lies elsewhere.
Thank you, Dr. AC. Finally, very, very, very briefly, Franklin,
Well, my understanding of leadership has been obviously solidified even before I got here. You either lead, you follow, you get out of the way. Mm-hmm. But having said that, I've run a think tank for almost 14 years, and I've seen the barriers young people, however educated they are, however wonderful they can be. And I like Jess's example. I mean, some of us actually invested in MP degree to come to what it has become today. But we saw the swath of barriers that we had to face. For simply not greeting somebody in Geneva was a reason why MP degree delayed in Ghana. And I asked myself, and this is supposed to be a leader, really? So for me, I can understand, and I do believe that individually we are endowed. We can do creative things, we can innovate and do beautiful things. But if you have the people who have to push you, who are sitting up there and make it difficult for you, well, there may be shining lights. But shining lights and individual shining lights are not what the continent needs right now. We need loads of individual lights that are coordinated and being shepherded by reasonable leaders in power.
So we are all in this together. We are all in this together. That's the takeaway. Thank you very much. A round of applause for our panelists. I think they deserve an award for endurance because we've gone on for a long time and they've answered all the questions very admirably. So thank you very much. Franklin talked about creativity. So right now we have someone who's going to give us a spoken word presentation. That is Rhyme Sonny, and he's going to give us a little presentation to show his creativity on leadership. Let's give him a round of applause.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman.
Good evening.
And our wonderful panelists. See, the few who are enriching themselves today at the expense of the majority must understand that the majority who are suffering today cannot guarantee the safety of the few who are enriching themselves today. Conformists, now non-conformists, we have become pessimists because of our experiences as optimists. Because they keep telling us they will change our metals to gold like they are some kind of alchemist. Chemist, you miss light kaolin and sodium hydrogen carbonate for us to offset our stomach upset. You are upset. We are down, frustrated and upset because for years we have stomached the various set of lies you fed us. Poison. Now give us one tangible reason why we should not spit in your face next season. Is it not all about our monies? Is it not all about your cronies? Families have become our worst enemies, and Ghana, Africa, we have to pray. But hey, we keep praying against these enemies, avoiding them by any means, but these enemies keep finding many means to execute their plans. Same group, different clans, different item in similar cans. NNDP, CCP, PPP, New National Democratic Patriotic Convention, Congress, Progressive People's Political Parties. Listen, your activities is moving the nation back like the Al-Qaeda dance. Ghana, Bremo, Al-Qaeda, why did they do we so? Well, I don't even blame them. I blame those poor souls whose souls were sold in the form of votes to these foes, foes of our souls. You have erected poles for them to score their goals, goals of corruption, foes of mismanagement, free kicks of kickbacks, kicking back our freedom, making us losers like the game of chairs. You keep changing them every 4 years, like the musical chairs, and you think that is a solution? When your take-home pay cannot even take you home? When you don't have anything to call your own, see, the meat is left with the bone. Omari namna manaka dompe, Ghana dan is crafts, ye di koko kompe, and put your beton is say, ye betchen is say, nabusa onse ye cha, ubenya sen. Now let me tell you how they do it. See, they carve words to impress, address the press. They will promise progress. But after you have given them the yes, they take all the largesse, digress from the expressway to success. They stress to impress their masters whilst you and I live in the mess. Life is full of stress and sometimes can hinder one's desire to progress. God has blessed us, yes, and we want to see this nation progress. So why are people working harder to make sure this blessing become a curse? You could not make money out of tro-tro, and today you're talking about taxes. So many taxes, we don't even know where our taxes. The task is, we need to identify new taxpayers, not new taxes. And whoever is in charge of our finances, please, if you can't widen the tax net, please take a back seat. I heard somebody saying, widen the tax net, a lot of taxpayers will fall out. So we need an IMF bailout. This is the joke of the century. Let's go and read our economic history. Is this not the land of gold, royal? Haven't we found oil? Don't we have fertile soil? So why are our leaders taking us in a spiral roll like the mosquito coil? Not even in the Rolls Royce, in the Utah bus. You've torn our backs for your selfish gains. See, I agree that we've made modest economic gains. We've had significant rains. But where are the grains of the farm plains? Ghana's food basket. So guys, if we don't talk, we'll choke on our words unspoken. They will tell you every project is in the pipeline. Plans are far advanced. Measures are being taken. So I ask, why don't you advance the plan, take the measures, and clear the projects in the pipeline? I wish every nation has a deadline. Like you will see in the tabloids, banner headline. Ghana is dead, bold, underlined. Thank you.
Thank you, Rhyme Sonny, for that very spirited performance. And I would like to also thank our panelists as they will be leaving the stage now. I want to thank Franklin Cudjoe. Thank you very much for your time. Dr. A.C. Ansah. Raphael Obonyo. I hope I got that right. Jesse Agyepong. And in Nigeria, Audu, Maikori. So thank you very much for your time. Please take your seats. We are talking about wonderful leaders and wonderful individuals. And we have a lady coming up that some of us may be aware of, but she's still a person who we need to celebrate. And I think we have a short individual. So ladies and gentlemen, let me just have your attention for this documentary.
Disability rights advocate. I had the best childhood that anybody can have. I was brought up in a nuclear family setting. I spent the first 9 years of my life traveling all over the world because my father used to work with the UNDP. So every 2 years we moved to a different country. And So that was my childhood until we settled in Ghana when I was 9 years old. I was homeschooled by my mother until I was 12 years old. And then I entered mainstream school for the first time when I was 12 years old. I had a good solid foundation because of the one-on-one attention that I got from my mother being her only student. So it was easy for me to transition into mainstream school and compete equitably with all my peers. I have cerebral palsy. Cerebral palsy is is a disability that affects the motor development of the patient. It's depending on the part that is damaged, it can be better or can be worse than what I have now. Because I had a problem with my handwriting, I started using computers at a very early age, and thus it was natural for me to use a computer to work. So when it came to choosing my career, I had a lot of opportunity with a computer already, so it was easier for me to transition into that career path. It's up to us to realize that, okay, if I can do something within the small corner of the world, which will make a difference to the lives of 2, 3, 4 people, who knows, maybe they will go out and make a difference to other people's lives. And that is how it should be. And I think there are people who are born leaders and there are people who learn how to be leaders. And if you are one of those who are lucky enough to be born a leader, then you have no choice but to pick up the mantle and run. If you are the kind of person who circumstances have made you a leader, then you have to learn very fast. But there are lots of people who listen to you and follow you. And that means you are responsible for leading them astray. Or you are responsible for leading them to their destiny. You don't have a day off. Because as soon as somebody calls you, you are expected to provide answers to their solution. Even when you yourself don't have those answers. So it's very important that you know that you are always on call and you have to provide good leadership and good answers to whatever it is you are asking. About. It's selflessness as well as having a vision and knowing where you want to go and knowing what you want to achieve and knowing how you want to achieve it. I would say that they should listen to their citizens and realize that
where will it be? By the
people. Power is not for them, it is for the people. So they should know that when they are elected into office, it's a privilege, it's not a right. So they should do what they have to do to serve the people, because I believe when you are a leader, you are also a servant, you are serving the people. And as a servant, you listen to your master, you do what they want to be done. And I also like to tell them to promote the rights of people with disabilities, because that is one area that all African countries are not doing well in at all.
At Leadership Ghana and Transition Africa as well, we talk about self-leadership being the basis of leading others. If you are able to lead yourself, you can lead others. One grows out of the other. And when we hear of stories like this about remarkable individuals who, despite many challenges, have been able to lead themselves, not wallow in self-pity, and go on to lead other people and even create employment for people who might be less disadvantaged, it's an amazing story. So I'm very humbled now because we are going to present an award to this remarkable human being. And to do that, I call on the Bishop of the Methodist Church. Okay, sorry, it has been changed. I'm going to call on a face we know very well, Mr. Frank. Please come and let's see how we can honor this very special lady. So.
I'll give you a microphone.
there's an inscription here, but I didn't bring my glasses, so I just read it from here. I present this on behalf of Transition Africa to Ms. Farida Ifua Bedwe. This award is in recognition of your journey of outstanding self-leadership, achievements, and personal excellence. And it's to encourage you to do more and for people to emulate what you are doing and keep going. This.
I think everything has already been said. I don't have anything else to say. But I've been listening to the discussion going on with the panelists, and it's been very interesting to get people's opinion on what leadership is. For me, I believe in self-leadership. I believe that in spite of your circumstances, in spite of the environment, you can, if you have it in you, you can do amazing things. And that is the most important thing that we have to take away from this. And sure, we are paying taxes. It is annoying when things are not being done our way. That one I'm not, I will be the first person to complain about a lot of things. But beyond that, what are you also doing? How are you brightening the little corner of your world? When you can answer that question, and you can make a small change in the little corner of your world, hopefully it will reciprocate across the whole world. And for me, that has been my number one motivation. I did not set out to be a leader. Anybody who knew me as a child will wonder, is it the same person? Because I was very shy, very inhibited, not very open or anything. But then circumstances have put me in this position. One thing that I'll say about being a leader is that you are always on call. So you cannot allow your guard to go down ever. I remember one day I went to, I don't know how many of you know Lansdowne. Lansdowne is a really secluded place in Kitar City. And I went there with my business partner. We were going to have a strategic meeting. I think that I got the gateman knew me. He said he had seen me on TV before. I'm like, so if I had come here with my boyfriend to do something, everybody would have known. I went to Rwanda as well last month. I was walking down the conference ground. Somebody saw me and said, are you the one who was on CNN? And I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, here too, I cannot be myself. I cannot do what I want. So it's like you're always on call. You have to remember that you have a responsibility toward the people you lead, whether you like it or not. And you have to always keep that image, because a lot of people are counting on you. So you are not allowed to have a bad day. When you have a bad day, you either stick to yourself so that nobody will see you. Because if you have a bad day and somebody approaches you, you are not allowed to snap at the person or whatever. So for me, that is my definition of leadership. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's be on our feet and give her a standing ovation, because this is a remarkable triumph of the human spirit over adversity. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. Thank you very much. You may take your seats. I want to thank Mr. Frank Agyekum for presenting this award impromptu. Thank you very much. And I also want to thank the Business and Financial Times, Joy FM, Peace FM, Innovate, Rytel, TEDx Accra, Alisa Hotel,
iConcepts PR, and everybody else who supported this program being the Leadership Factor Conference, a Transition Africa project coming to you from Accra. Before we have the closing remarks and vote of thanks, I just want to invite you to a cocktail party by the swimming pool after the program is done so that you can have some refreshment before you leave as a reward for you staying to the end of this very important and eye-opening program. So without further ado, I'll call on Henrietta Ajete to come and give us the closing remarks, and then we will go to our cocktail party. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your time. And I leave you with Henrietta, and then I'll meet you outside for the cocktail.
Thank you all once again from Transition Africa. First of all, we want to say a very big thank you to God Almighty. I believe that as organizers, one of the things you are really praying about to go well is the good weather, and we had that. And so we thank God Almighty for making that possible. We want to thank our special guest, Her Excellency, Madam Usaka. Thank you so much for coming. And thank you, Frank Agyekum, for stepping in for the ex-president, John Agyekum Kuffour. And then a very big thank you to our speakers. Thank you, AC Franklin. Thank you, Jesse, Raphael, all the way from Kenya. Thank you, Audu, who came on Google Hangout all the way from Nigeria. Thank you for your time. We also want to say a very big thank you to Rhyme Sony. That was a powerful performance. Thank you so much. And then quickly, thank our partners, Google, Joy FM, Alisa Hotel Mid Center, and then TEDx. And then the final and a very big thank you to you, audience. I think you deserve a round of applause. Yes, thank you so much for staying right from the beginning till now. And Transition Africa says, thank you. Go out there and let's lead change. Thank you.